Our next speaker is going to be sharing a little bit of insight, and it's, again, one of the wonderful things about a conference of this nature is you've got people who are visiting from abroad who are telling us about their experiences. So it's like an outsider sharing their insight. Earlier, we had Charlie Ill discussing his experience about investing in Pakistan. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome a guest from Singapore who will be talking about investing in Asia's mass market. Everyone, please welcome Beau Seil.
There's still so many very basic pain points which have not been solved in Southeast Asia. From the way retail is done, 80% is still taking place in the small mom and pop shops and traditional like wet markets. It's mind-blowing. Also, the number of people who are still unbanked or don't have access to basic financial services. There's so many opportunities, whether we look at healthcare, education, agriculture. Right now, we have this wave of entrepreneurs who finally have the skill set to really tackle these problems.
Well, I just want to start off by saying it is really exciting to be here. This is my second trip to Pakistan. And what a difference, I would say, 10 years in my life has made. About 10 years ago, or I should say 12 years ago, we had started investing in a couple markets, which some of you are probably paying a lot of attention to. We were some of the earliest investors into microfinance institutions in India. We then moved on and started investing in countries like Indonesia, Philippines, and Vietnam. And I think one of the greatest things for me is if I thought that I would be here in Pakistan today, 10 years ago, watching a panel of amazing entrepreneurs talk about how they were going to be the best positioned or get in an argument about why their solution is the best way of moving millions of people, I would have thought it was crazy. And so, you know, as we've gone around for the last 10 years, started to invest in companies very similar to some of these great entrepreneurs that you saw up here, you know, it's just a testament to how quickly things are moving, how quickly solutions are being developed, and then how quickly these markets are moving. So a little bit about Patamar. We, starting about 15 years ago as a group of people, started to recognize there were millions and then billions of people who were not being served by traditional models. We started to look at financial services. We then started looking at healthcare, education, agriculture, you name it. And we thought to ourselves, how could technology and technology entrepreneurs start to deal with some of these challenges? So, you know, Patamar's whole premise is that there's people just like you out in the audience who understand things that are going on locally in this market and in other markets that are facing the same challenges to deal with this issue. The mass market being low and middle income people who no one has ever been trying to solve their problems for, right? We saw a very big difference. If you look at the 10 cent story, anybody you talk to now, who's going to disagree with me that trying to build platforms to serve the mass market is a bad idea? And you know, I think to myself, everybody's gotten used to this. Everybody's gotten used to this idea. Everybody's gotten used to looking at entrepreneurs and companies trying to solve that problem. There's only one thing that I've noticed recently that hasn't gotten used to a big white guy like me running around these markets, and that's essentially birds who continue to run into my head because they're not quite sure they're not used to someone of my height walking around. So as we move forward, you know, the way that we look at the mass market is the mass market of consumers who've never had products and services that meet their needs, or SMEs. You know, most of the economic growth going on here in Pakistan, in Indonesia, in Vietnam, and in other countries similar to this, there's very few people who've built platforms to do this. But if now we look at what are the biggest companies in countries like Indonesia, you've got Bukalapak, which is bringing the millions of small and medium enterprises in Indonesia onto a common platform. You've got companies like M Clinica that are bringing all of the pharmacists in six countries across Southeast Asia onto a common platform and building a marketplace to serve their needs. So the key sectors and themes that we focus on, financial services and tech-enabled distribution platforms that many of you are already building, and no one would have ever thought 10 years ago that these types of models could have been built. And why is this? Why do we at Patamar love focusing on these markets? It's because of the economic growth that's going on, high density of population, you know, large numbers of low and middle income people who've never had their needs met, and also really great investment opportunities to back incredible entrepreneurs who are coming back home or who are developing solutions right here in this market. So one of the things that we've found interesting as well, and I think this is one of the challenges and yet opportunities that are faced here in Pakistan, is that if you actually look up here, and a lot of people know this data, but when I was living in China back in 2008, they were starting to really get close to this time period when monetization was picking up. Per capita GDPs were reaching somewhere in the neighborhood of $6,000 to $7,000 per year, and then all of a sudden everyone believed that Chinese companies weren't just copycats that were trying to do what was being done in the U.S. So if you look now down at Southeast Asia is essentially about 10 years behind where China was. What are you starting to see with companies in Indonesia at the current time? In companies in Vietnam, you're starting to see unicorns come together for the very first time. So if we think about what's going on here in Pakistan, it's probably a few years behind. But I think one of the amazing things, and I've been talking with some different folks about this over the last couple days, is when I first came to Pakistan, I said to myself, the Pakistan market feels like it was where Indonesia was about 8 or 9 years ago. And on this trip, I think I had to eat my words. And I'm curious of why you think I should eat my words. You know, why I was wrong when I made that assessment. And the more and more I've gotten to see entrepreneurs, talk with entrepreneurs, and look at different business models and how things are taking off, essentially what it is that companies have been being built here in Pakistan for how long? What technology companies? When did people start working on these models? I mean, there's more being born every day, but things have been happening here for 6, 7, 8 years. Amazing science, technology, engineering, and math talent that comes out of Pakistan. Great companies that have been built here, serving the domestic market. What's the only thing that has not been here? There hasn't been a lot of investment capital. And then you have a challenge with per capita GDP. So as these things start to change, I'm pretty convinced that all these other dynamics are going to change as well. And so, you know, I want to give you one story because about 10 years ago, when I first started investing into Indonesia, I used to talk with a lot of the family offices there, a lot of the large conglomerates. I would talk with entrepreneurs. I would talk with technology leaders. And they used to say to me, oh, but you just don't get it. You just don't get it. Indonesia will never be like China. Indonesia will never be like the U.S. There's so many things that are working against us here. You have these huge companies that own everything. They'll just never let these entrepreneurs succeed. You know, there's no venture capital here. This is not going to change. Now where do I go? I go to the Philippines. What's the story that I hear there? It's exactly the same. What's the story that sometimes I run into here in Pakistan? It's pretty much the same. So what's changed? Essentially, everything's changing. You have entrepreneurs taking it upon themselves to build these types of companies. You're starting to see venture capital flow in. You're starting to see these big announcements. You're seeing Mustafa come in with Swivel from another market. You know, things are changing very fast. So what I like to tell people is, I've been to this movie before. You know, the characters are a little bit different. The plot's a little bit different. There's different things that happen. But at the end of the day, it's kind of like a Star Wars movie or one of these end-of-the-world movies where everybody, you know, is all freaked out that the world's going to end and then somebody comes in and saves it at the end of the day. They're kind of all the same plot. But you know what? They all kind of end up in the same place. Is if we fundamentally believe in the future of Pakistan, the future of digitization, the future of technology to make a change in people's lives, there is nothing holding back this country and the entrepreneurs building these businesses from actually succeeding. There'll be families that have said, oh man, I missed out. I should have done those same things that those entrepreneurs were doing. They'll get left in the dust. Many of you in this room will be the people who build those companies that essentially become category kings and queens. So I'll share with you one story. This was an investment that we made back in 2011. It's a really bright guy named Aldi Haryapratomo out of Indonesia. I met him. He was at Harvard Business School at the time. He was a middle-income guy. He put himself through Purdue and computer science engineering. Then he went and worked and did some consulting projects. Then he went to a group called Kiva, which was one of the first online microfinance lenders. He built their whole IT system. They went on to Oprah. The whole system melted down because they couldn't deal with the volume that was coming through. And so Aldi went on and he said, you know what, I want to help small shopkeepers in Indonesia make more money and have access to more and more products that they can sell to their customers that meet their customers' needs. So he came up with this idea for Rumah, which got rebranded as Mapan. And Mapan means financially self-sufficient, you're on your own two feet, you're doing really well. So Mapan, we led an investment in early 2012. After Aldi had competed against himself at Harvard Business School's enterprise competition. He got first and third place, and I'm pretty convinced he didn't get second place because they just wouldn't give the same guy first and second place in a competition. But we made an investment alongside a group called Omidyar Network, which some of you may know. Omidyar Network is the family office of a guy named Pierre Omidyar, who was the founder of eBay. And Aldi's vision was, I want to just unlock economic opportunities for low-income shopkeepers across Indonesia. We made that investment. The company iterated, got to a point where they were raising a Series B round. Golden Gate Ventures out of Singapore joined us. Then SEA, which is the largest internet and gaming company in Southeast Asia, came in the Series C. And then a company which many of you may know called Gojek acquired the business. When we first made that investment, we had predictions of who would acquire Rumah. Gojek barely existed. Actually, Gojek was in the basement of Rumah. So Nadim and Aldi were very close friends, decided to split rent. They were in the same building. There were three Gojek guys downstairs, and there are about 15 Rumah guys upstairs. And now where's Aldi? He's running all of GoPay. And GoPay is essentially trying to be the Ant Financial of Southeast Asia. So this is what I'm saying is how quickly things change. And you can't even begin to understand it. Because when we're in the middle of it, things don't seem like they're changing fast enough. But you know, 8 years ago when I sat down with Aldi and I said, what's the goal of Rumah, goal of Mapan? It's essentially to help shopkeepers and to enable financial services for low-income people all across the country. I was with him 2 weeks ago. We were meeting with the head of Visa for the region. And I said, Aldi, what's different for you? And he said, man, now I get to do all of the things I ever wanted to do on trying to essentially help low and middle income people all across the region get access to financial service and be treated like true customers. So this rate of change is incredibly fast. And I think as many of you build businesses where you're essentially looking at the mass market and you're saying to yourself, this is a big opportunity. This is a big opportunity to make money. This is a big opportunity to employ a lot of people. I would say there's one other thing that's really important in this journey. How do you select a key group of investors, a key group of stakeholders, to actually solve some of the biggest problems that you're seeing in your market? You will be building platforms which essentially have the reach to be able to do things that have never been possible in emerging markets. You can reach more people than anybody's reached. In Silicon Valley, there's a big outcry of saying, how is technology really solving problems? And people are saying, well, we're solving problems because of, you know, we're going to help people, you know, get their dogs walked. You know, and I try and share with people, we're trying to build essentially companies that are trying to make sure people get access to food, get access to finance, get access to transportation, make it so they don't have to spend their entire lives on a four-hour commute. You know, the carpocalypse that we call it in some markets like in Manila and others, where people are spending a large portion of their day and their lives essentially trapped in cars as they're trying to just get to and from a livelihood or work opportunity is crazy. So as you start to build these companies, one of the things that I would challenge you with is to think about how these platforms can essentially be used to continue to layer on other types of products and services, which may in the short term not seem like they're a quick hit and a quick business opportunity, but for the very, very long term, you're actually going to be involved in nation building. You're going to be involved in unlocking economic opportunities for more and more people, which will essentially help propel this country and other countries similarly positioned to Pakistan to actually create an enormous change. You will be involved in nation building, whether you know it or not. The question for you is, what is the type of nation that we truly want to build? Thank you.